Hello and welcome to Soberanía, the Mexican Politics Podcast. I'm your co-host, José Luis Granados Ceja, a Mexican-born journalist living and working in Mexico City. I'm a staff writer as well as host of the podcast over at Venezuela Analysis. And as always, I'm joined by my co-host, Kurt Hackbarth. Kurt, how you doing? Welcome to the show.
Very well, José Luis. My name is Kurt Hackbarth, writing for Jacobin magazine in the United States and Sentido Común here in Mexico, ready for episode 10 of Soberanía.
Can we believe it? 10 episodes. We want to thank all of our listeners, our loyal listeners tuning in every week and listening to our program and leaving the comments. I always appreciate reading those comments. I really feel a good sense of satisfaction knowing that it's useful for people. This is what we're doing. It's a labor of love, and honestly, I do enjoy it. We got lots to talk about this week because last night, the big debate, again, debate number two. And, you know, you and I were texting beforehand, and you made a really good point that I thought we should mention here on the program, which is that, you know, this was shaping up to be a turning point for Xóchitl Gálvez. If she did another terrible performance like she did in the first one, it was likely going to spell the doom, possibly the collapse of her vote. But it looks like she did a little bit better. Looks like she learned some lessons from the first debate. And I don't think we can say that she did a terrible job, but I don't think she won the debate. I don't think she did a great job either. And I think if I'm going to sum it up in anything, I've been calling it a performance to stop the bleeding. I think it was clear to her and her campaign that they were not only not winning people over, but they, in fact, they were losing support amongst their own base, that hardcore anti-López Obrador, anti-Cuarta Transformación vote. And it was a desperate effort to try to save that, maybe over time building on that if she was successful enough. And if that is the criteria that we're using, did she shore up the base of her support? Well, I think we could look to the reaction of some of the punditry. I think if you're ever curious, what does the opposition thinking heads, talking heads have to say? Well, you just have to tune into Latinas. So I sacrificed myself, loyal listeners. I subjected myself to that abuse and listened to what Latinos had to say, and they were really happy.
We do it so you don't have to.
Yeah. Exactly.
Remember that when we launched our Patreon. Yep.
Yeah. And that means that, so she accomplished that sense. She shored up the anti-López Obrador vote, but I don't think she won anybody else over. And they are convinced that by not doing a bad job, she won the debate. But I think the truth is, at best, she kind of held her head above water in this case. Your immediate thoughts, Kurt, before we move into some of the
questions. My immediate reaction, José Luis, is as we've been talking about over the last few weeks, Xóchitl Gálvez already came into the second debate with high negative ratings. And pretty much, you know, it's axiomatic in kind of debate lore that when you go in with high negatives and you try to go negative, that tends to bounce back against you. I actually have a graphic here that's how her negative ratings soared in that period. Right? With this ankle pull. And you can see here in January of 2024, before the debate started, her negative rating, or what's called in Spanish the tasa de rechazo, Spanish is even more brutal in that sense. It's the rejection rate. Was already at 40%.
Ouch.
Right? Whereas this is the percentage of people who said they'd never vote for Xóchitl Gálvez, right? Jorge Maynes, the third-party candidate for Movimiento Ciudadano, was in the 20s, and Claudia Sheinbaum was down at 11, right? Only 11% of people said they'd never vote for Sheinbaum, right? In February, Galvez's negatives stayed pretty much stable, but then by April, they shot up to 48%. That's practically half of the electorate. Saying that they'll never vote for Xóchitl Gálvez. That's pretty damning, because in there was that first debate, which we analyzed with Violeta Vázquez Rojas, how Xóchitl tried to play the card of Claudia Sheinbaum being, a cold and heartless woman, right? And so she repeated this over and over, cold and heartless, cold and heartless, cold and heartless. Last night, it was the woman of lies. And Xóchitl Gálvez very predictably went negative again. Now, as José Luis pointed out, it wasn't a disaster like the first debate. It didn't have blatant and open gaffes like holding graphics upside down or, you know, other silliness like that. She was, you know, reasonably coherent. She got her attacks off. But that's a pretty low bar. That's a pretty low bar. In other words, what she managed to do was not further alienate her base, the 30% of Mexico that's, you know, hates AMLO to a feverish, frothy pitch and will vote for, you know, a bowl of Jell-O over, you know, the 4T, right? So she didn't further alienate what should be a base that should be already on her side. That base should already be there with her. And, you know, they were discouraged and disheartened after the first debate. Latinos was all, they were all in their cups over there. They were all crying into their coffee, right? So she managed to get some of them back on side, right? The Latinas people, Leon Krause, you know, people like that. Leo Zuckerman, right? Although René Delgado, right, of Tercer Grado said that Claudia won the debate. So it was a pretty low bar for her. The problem with Xochitl's attacks is they were, as she is, all over the place. You know, I think if you're going to attack, they have to be well-focused attacks that you can back up and keep hitting on. So what Xochitl Galvez did is she was kind of trying to, again, the throw the spaghetti at the wall and see what sticks. So she starts off calling Claudia Sheinbaum the narco candidate, and we've, you know, talked about you know, the foreign media attacks behind that, but she didn't go into it. Then she was attacking her on fiscal paradises. She was attacking her on a family business that her father once had. She was attacking her on spending on her image. She was attacking her on Pemex, you know, one after the other after the other, and she was just kind of bouncing around. And so at one point in the debate, it was very interesting to watch Claudia simply just not answer. You know, the moderator said, do you want to respond to this? Nah. You know, you know, I don't have to respond to this corrupt person over here. This isn't an interrogation, you know. This is a debate, and I'm laying out my proposals. You know, she did have her jabs in there to, you know, set things straight. But, you know, the important thing is Claudia Sheinbaum didn't dejarse enganchar, right? She didn't get hooked in and provoked. And I was watching the debate with a friend, and we kind of came to the kind of conclusion. It was kind of like the Chapulín Colorado, you know, when he's in there trying to swing and they're just holding him by the head.
Right.
You know, if anybody's ever seen that program, they're holding him by the head and he's swinging as much as he can, but the jabs aren't hitting because they're kind of desperate.
Yeah.
You know, and as López Obrador also points out, if you're going to go on the attack in politics, which is part of politics, you have to have a degree of moral authority to back up those attacks. Otherwise, exactly. They just seem dirty, right?
That's,
and at the same time as Xochitl Galvez is jabbing away like the Chapulín, you know, she's blatantly admitting that she continues to funnel contracts to her family business while a senator, you know, a blatant conflict of interest. Xochitl Galvez also was very much related with the real estate cartel, right, which Claudia Sheinbaum very clearly pointed out, and we'll talk about a little bit later in this program. She got some basic facts wrong. She said, oh, we have to deal with water, the water issue, but she was also in favor of the Texcoco airport, which was going to plunk an airport down on top of a lake. That she said, well, we can store water in the Texcoco lake, and Claudia Sheinbaum just said, it's a saltwater lake. You know, basically it's a saltwater lake, you idiot. Without saying, you idiot.
Yeah.
Right?
I think that was one of the major topics all over social media when it happened. It's one of those viral moments where people, and I think she was trying to go for that at the beginning, Xochitl Galvez, kind of with all these attacks and mentioning that meme that was circulating last week. But I think that that line, Texcoco is a salty lake, it's not going to work, I think is the one that really resonated. It's kind of the big takeaway. You know, these things are, it's a lot of performance, right? This is, debates are not really about conflicting, contrasting ideas, but really about who's going to score points. And if it's about scoring points, that alone puts her above, puts Claudia Sheinbaum above her. And I left the graphic up because I keep repeating this point that you've been making. I think it's underanalyzed. I think she obviously went more negative. You know, she went from
even more
cold, icy woman to the candidate of lies, right? And bringing up
even
her
holding up these childish signs of, you know, she's the candidate of lies. She's the candidate of lies.
Yeah.
Liar here, you know, liar to the right of me. to the point that the moderators had to say, stop it.
Yeah.
Put Although the I signs think that was down and I'm talking. Yeah, of course
she promised she was going to be herself, right? She was going to be, and so she was going to be more rebellious, right? She kind of, kind of for our U.S. listeners, like John McCain pretends to be a maverick, but actually isn't a maverick in any kind of authentic sense of the word. And so I think maybe some of these numbers, if it's going to stay around there, 40, and it might actually go up, right? I think people are being turned off by this kind of, you know, I had my daughter watching with us, and, you know, she's like, why is she act so infantile? And I think that's the takeaway for most people who aren't that politically engaged.
She was doing this while Claudia was talking, like, blah, blah, blah.
Exactly. Yeah, for our listeners, she quite literally, you know, pretended her hand was a mouth when Claudia was talking. And that kind of stuff doesn't fly well. Again, we talked about this after the last debate, which is that, you know, you also have to present yourself as presidential. People have to be convinced that you are dignified enough to occupy the office of the presidency. I know, and we can get into like, oh, well, you know, what does that really say, signifier, signified? But the truth is that's how people think, right? That is an important decision that people factor in people's decision. And if that is the case, again, who looked more poised? Who looked more comfortable? Who? I will say this, though. Xóchitl was more confident. At least she was able to a little bit be more confident in her own skin, but I don't think it actually translated that much into it. And the truth is, we look at this graphic here on the screen, which shows that her disapproval rate keeps going up. You know, it also tends to coincide with the rejection that people have for the old regime, right? This,
yes.
She cannot escape the fact that she is the candidate of the old regime. That is who she like represents, and in fact was trying to hide from it in the previous debate. And we have this this clip here that I want to share with you, where we can see kind of what was her attitude in the first one, right? So we're just gonna put this up real quick. And this is Xóchitl Gálvez during the first debate.
Una mujer que nunca ha militado en ningún partido político y no militaré. Una mujer que nunca ha militado en ningún partido político y no militaré.
So she says, I've never been a member of a political party and I never will, right? Even though she is there on behalf of a coalition called Strength and Heart for Mexico, on behalf of the PAN, the right-wing political party in this country, the PRI, which ruled this country for 70 years, and the PRD, what's left of what was once a progressive social democratic party, but is no longer.
Yo soy la candidata del PAN, del PRI y del PRD.
And then in the second debate, finally accepts, I am the candidate of the PAN, PRI, PRD. And that's what she can't get away from, right? That is what I think is really weighing her down. Even if she wasn't a candidate that's prone to committing gaffes, even if she was better performances, had better performances in the debate, she would still be weighted down by this, by the fact that she is the candidate of the PRI, the PAN, and the PRD, and the most of the population rejects them. Like you said, there is that hardcore vote that would vote for anything. You could run a paper bag and they would vote for it if it wasn't somebody against López Obrador. But then there's the rest of the country, which is what, 70% at least, that says, actually, my life has improved. And I thought that was one of the takeaways, really strong moments for Claudia, is that I will say this about the debate. At least it presented us with a better case of contrasting visions, where there was actually quite evident to anybody who's watching that there's sort of one candidate who represents neoliberal orthodoxy, who wants to privatize, who thinks that the market is a solution. She had an answer that I thought was incredible when they talked about raising people's salaries. And her answer was, actually, what we need to do is take care of the business owners first. And then they alone, they will reduce the work week and they will raise the wages. Like, unbelievable. But it tells you what's her ideology. And then it stands in stark contrast to Morena and Claudia, which have a progressive vision. She talked about all of the achievements. She talked about the increase in the minimum wage. She talked about the social programs, all of the successes that are had a material improvement in people's lives. And the reason why it's actually quite a relatively simple campaign for her. I promise that we're going to keep doing the things that you like. And I think Xóchitl doesn't have quite a good answer when it comes to that.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of hard amongst all of these, you know, Chaplin-style attacks to get a sense of Xóchitl's platform because she has very little in the way of specific proposals. But you're right. You know, in and amongst all of that, the two visions for the country are there. You talked about her response to the idea of limiting the work week, right? Which Morena still has pending, the 40 hours, people, Morena, you know, don't let Mines grab this issue away just because you're, you know, treading water on that. But the other issue was electricity, right? And Xóchitl Gálvez said, we want to go back to the rondas eléctricas. And the rondas eléctricas, for people don't know, it's a way of handing over the electrical grid to private companies and buying electricity through auctions of energy that the government is then required to buy, you know? And that's exactly the model that's in Spain, right? Yeah. The rondas eléctricas. If you go to Spain, they get their electricity bill directly from Iberdrola, right? Spain is required, they do. And they're required to buy the energy from these, you know, at the prices set, right? So they can't even negotiate, right? And that's what they want. Here they had this version of the auctions of energy system in Mexico. They tried to reform that with the energy law, which went to the Supreme Court, and that's going to be a big fight going forward, right? Because Felipe Calderón, let's not forget, the former president by fraud, what did he do after leaving office? He went to work for a subsidiary of Iberdrola on their board.
Yeah,
right. So that's going to.
It took us 15 minutes, but we finally mentioned Jorge Álvarez Máñez. Can't forget he is a candidate. He is the third. He doesn't have a realistic shot, but we should mention him because I think one of the also underanalyzed elements of this debate is what's going to be the impact of the fact that he had a really good performance, right? He is still trying to present himself to the population, present their ideas, kind of try to this ni ellos ni aquellos kind of political position that neither them nor the other guys. And I think he did a good job. And in fact, his attacks were actually quite good against Xóchitl Gálvez, pointing out some of her inconsistencies and mistakes in her logic or some of his disagreements with her electoral program. And I think the fact that he did a pretty good job is likely to spell more bad news for Xóchitl Gálvez, because he's not taking votes away from the Morena bloc. People aren't switching from Morena to Movimiento Ciudadano. If anything, it's taking votes away from Xóchitl Gálvez. And so his strong performance, I think, is also bad news for Xóchitl Gálvez, despite what the pundits say about her having, quote unquote, won the debate last night.
I agree with that. And two more points. You know, Xóchitl is gaffe prone, and this is just a problem, right? Some of them weren't as blatant as the first debate, but they were still there, right? When she was tried to make hay of the fact that she had been on the National Commission for the Development of Indigenous Peoples, right, back during the Fox administration. And she said, I electrified the indigenous pueblos.
Yeah.
Like, she did that, right? Really? that was quite the gaffe. And then she made this very weird comment that nearshoring is coming to Mexico, but it's not here, or it's leaving again. It's like, well, then it isn't nearshoring, is it, right? If it's going somewhere else, it's farshoring. Right?
Yeah, they're not going to Canada.
So she gets... yeah, she gets... tangled. She gets just tangled up when she goes off of her script. She's got her cards and she's got her script. You can see she very much reads things. When she tries to go off the cuff, that's when the gaffes start. And actually, Claudia Sheinbaum was all over Xóchitl Gálvez's time in the National Commission for Indigenous Peoples, pointing out first that she's all very in favor of indigenous people. But when there was the repression in Atenco in 2006, when they were trying to put the airport over by Texcoco and buy their, you know, buy their land for pennies on the dollar, there was just a brutal repression under Calderón and then Governor Peña Nieto. Xóchitl Gálvez said nothing. And then she also pointed out that Gálvez, they had opened 10 open pit mining projects in indigenous territories during Xóchitl Gálvez's time there, right?
Yeah. You know, and for a minute there, she was trying to almost have her cake and eat it too, in the sense that she's like, no, I'm a citizen candidate, but I have government experience under Fox. But Fox is over in his ranch, and I'm my own woman, yeah, and all this kind of stuff, right? Like, you either accept the baggage that comes with coming from the old regime, or reject it and actually present yourself as a citizen candidate. She's kind of been between both, and ultimately you're fooling nobody, right? That is, again, the advantage that Claudia has, saying, I can speak proudly of my party's record because we've done this, 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 and that. But I, you know, I'm really glad you mentioned the Atenco thing, right? Like, you know, there's this effort to try to cast the Morena government under López Obrador and the future potential government of Claudia Sheinbaum as authoritarianism in waiting, right? Or a backslide into authoritarianism and all this kind of stuff. But let's remember what the old regime was capable of. People should look up the case of the brutal repression against the people of San Salvador Atenco and how representative it was, in a sense, of the style of governance. That was the repressive era of Mexico, right? Where there was that kind of violent state.
Well, Oaxaca, 2006, I lived through that. I saw that. I was there for that.
Yeah.
And a video just surfaced last week of Ulises Ruiz, the then governor of Oaxaca, you know, trying to pay off people with suitcases full of money. So, you know, the past doesn't go away as quickly as they'd like.
Exactly. Ulises Ruiz of the PRI, who's still very active in the PRI. It's incredible that some of these tainted figures are still occupying important posts or have some kind of influence in the party. And again, she is the candidate of the PRI. You have to wear that. You are the candidate on that coalition. And so, you know, I don't think most people are being fooled by that, but I'm really glad that Claudia mentioned that, because people forget what authoritarianism actually looked like in this country and who was responsible for it. This idea that the corrupt narco candidates are the Morena candidates, meanwhile, they're the ones of Felipe Calderon, which is another point that Claudia made actually during the debate. She's like, no, 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 there hasn't been a narco government. The only narco government we had in this country was Felipe Calderon from the PAN, which you represent, because she claims she's never been a member of the PAN, but she's run for the PAN for governor in Hidalgo. She represented the PAN as the jefa delegacional here in Mexico City, and she's a senator for the PAN on their plurinominal list, on their unelected list, essentially. And so,
yeah, the party list candidate.
She is the PAN. She's representing the PRI. She is representing the PRD. You know, just by happenstance, I was next to Estudios Churubusco last night. I actually went to CENART. I always love talking about how amazing it is to live in Mexico City. Permit this aside real quick. It's just this incredible, beautiful space with these architectural marvels that's open to the public, free to enter. And we just, you know, watch these concerts, the kids, because it's Dia del Niño tomorrow here in Mexico. And so anyway, we were there and happened to be next to Estudios Churubusco, which is where the debate was being broadcast from. And the streets were just full of Morena supporters. There was a handful of supporters, but really you could kind of tell they were acarreados from the opposition candidate. But Morena was clearly well mobilized in this instance. And on that, I think I wanted to talk quite quickly here a little bit about the INE. Did they do a better job this time around? Or because there were lots of issues last time. What do you think, Kurt? How did it go in terms of the actual running of the event?
Not great. You know, in the first debate, there was all kinds of flubs. There was, they couldn't get the timing. They got the clock suspiciously wrong. They were withdrawing seconds from Claudia Sheinbaum. The supposed citizens' questions were, you know, really technocratic questions, you know. Last night, the problems were different. The studio was dark.
Yeah.
The moderators were meh. You know, I don't think worth 150,000 pesos a pop.
No, they were question readers. All they did was, this is your turn, this is the question.
Yeah, that's it, right?
Has more to do with the actual structure of the debate, the decisions that were made beforehand, but I think it really kind of limited the ability for those contrasting visions to make themselves even more evident.
Exactly. You know, I think the a good moderator does exactly that, moderates without intervening. And it is kind of a delicate balance. So I think, you know, just in order to try to avoid controversy, they just were as anodyne as possible. And the big problem was the internet kept cutting out. The transmission kept cutting out.
Yep.
And, you know, again, this is a very expensive, very costly electoral institute where the consejeros make big bucks. Big bucks. So get the transmission right.
Yeah, and they wash their hands.
Get the clock right. Get the lighting right.
A private company was in charge of running this. It's not our fault. Well, it kind of is, because the buck stops with you.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
The buck stops with you. And if you're outsourcing, why are you outsourcing? And if you are outsourcing, you have to be overseeing.
Yeah, it's not like they don't have the staff for it. They have a huge bloated bureaucracy over at the INE. And so,
and then these weird backgrounds, which look like Rorschach tests. Anyway, you know,
I think
it's just,
it was like a kind of Art Deco thing, and there was like a logo. Yeah. I was like, I even asked my partner that. I was like, "What is this logo? What is that exactly?" And they're like, "I think it's just for style."
It just looked very. I think the Spanish word is kind of chabacano. It just looked kind of shabby.
Yeah.
Just kind of not professional all around. You know, the camera takes, I think, were very far away, so it made the candidates look kind of distant. You know, just I don't know. It just. You know, and we'll be talking a little bit later about how the Electoral Institute in Mexico City is also in the headlines here. I don't want to take away from the segue here, but that's previews of coming attractions in this episode.
And before we go, I do want to put this last graphic up because it was interesting to see all of the
all
of the comments, all of the rest of it, right? But ultimately, who won? Now, let's ignore that first one for a second here. Overwhelmingly, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 polling companies found that Claudia Sheinbaum overwhelmingly won the debate. I think anybody who was watching, that's probably true. The only one, and the one that the bots are actually actively circulating right now on social media as we're recording, is the one from Massive Caller.
Massive Caller.
And, yep. You know, as you can see, they're claiming that somehow 56% of people vote agreed that Xochitl Galvez was a winner when, you know, it's the outlier. And I think the reason I make a point of mentioning this is because Massive Caller is also the only one that puts them even remotely close in terms of election polls ahead of the election here. That's going to happen on June 2nd. And I think really this serves to prove just they're not a reliable polling firm. They are clearly operating in the interest of advancing the agenda of the opposition candidate, trying to make the race seem closer, trying to make it seem like she won. Also, it's in the name. Massive Caller, although the post debates are almost always done by phone calls, Massive Caller, when it does regular polling, does it by phone, which are inherently less reliable. The other ones usually do a mix or completely in-house visits, where they'll actually even bring like a fake voting poll and everything to actually, you know, the act of actually depositing the vote and all this kind of stuff. So all that to say, next time you see Massive Caller, don't believe a word of what they're saying. It's just, frankly, unreliable at this point. Now, in some of the reaction, what we saw in particular was this emphasis that Xochitl Galvez did a really good job because the playing field is just so unfair. The playing field is just so tilted in favor. Quite literally, at one point, I forget, I think it was Héctor Aguilar Camín, but if I'm not mistaken. Anyway, I apologize if I'm wrong about that.
Known as Oligar Camín here in Mexico, right?
But it was one of the pundits on the Latinas one. And he was talking about how he literally held his hand up. He's like, Claudia Sheinbaum is playing this way, and she's playing with an inclined field. That's why she's able to score more goals. And Xochitl Galvez has to play upfield and all this kind of stuff. How true is that? How true can it be to suggest that this is a state election? I think if we're going to go through that exercise, it would be good to look at history. What is the history of elections in this country? How does it actually look like? And so there's a handful of tweets here that we have from a friend here in the program. I'm a big fan of his analysis. He does a show with Sin Embargo called Los Radicales, if I'm not mistaken, together with a couple other, with Alvaro Delgado and Baez, et cetera, et cetera.
Baez Varela and Carlos Perez Ricard. Yeah.
Thank you for filling that in there. And here he's talking about how Enrique Krause, surprise, surprise, not surprised to see that name come up, talks about how the Mexico is living a state election. And it's a bit of a weird thing to translate. Maybe you can help me out here, Kurt, but basically...
An election of states, kind of, what would we call that? Basically that, right, where the government basically tips the scales in favor of their chosen candidate.
Yeah, and that's been part of the narrative, which is that, oh, all of the state institutions are supporting it, et cetera, right? And so he talks about, this is a myth, that you can't be talking about this, right? Here Hector talks about how, in his article, Krause actually doesn't put any data, any actual evidence that sustains this, right? He only says that this is a state election because the president has his morning press conferences, right? et cetera, right? You know, the talks about the state of the election here, that what is the impact of the private media, et cetera, et cetera. But before I kind of keep going onto this thread, I actually wanted to go back to a separate one that he had prepared, where he talks about the same concept, right? This unfair playing field. But he talks about things that happened historically in elections in Mexico, which I think serves as a really good contrast. And why it's disingenuous that there are some voices today talking about the fact that there is an unfair playing field, right?
So it's like the whole thing with Atenco and Oaxaca in 2006,
yes.
Right? It's like they conveniently try to forget the past. And what Hector Alejandro Quintanar mentions is exactly what happened in that 2006 election at that same time.
And so he asks a bunch of questions here. He says, if this is an unfair election, has López Obrador put out nearly 500,000 illegal campaign ads using public money, like Fox did against López Obrador in 2006? No. He asks here, has AMLO's government created fake companies in order to move federal money and actually use that money to try to buy votes, as they did in the case of Vázquez Mota in that past election? Has Morena spent 682 million pesos on ads that violate regulations the way that they did in 2006 with Calderón's campaign, Peligro para México? No. Has AMLO's cabinet negotiated with the governors in order to manipulate the vote and force people to vote on behalf of parties to keep their social programs, as Fox did? No, he hasn't, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, this is a long list of tweets of all of these past incidents where there was, yes, very much an uneven playing field, where the resources of the state were used in order to favor one candidate over the other, where you saw direct intervention of elected figures, which is actually something that we've been critical of in this program, which is that I find that it actually goes a little bit too far in terms of limiting what elected officials can or cannot say in an election period. It was all created in a sense to try to, you know,
to try to counteract this,
exactly,
this stuff,
right? Like the way that the PRI used to do things in terms of really using every kind of mechanism that was available to it to put out its message and convince people to vote for their party. But I think the response to it, the actions of the electoral authorities in this country have gone a little bit too far in limiting that. Nonetheless, right, the kinds of things that we saw in the past that happened, right, I remember the Peligro para México when the then IFE, today INE, said, well, we can't limit freedom of expression. They have to be allowed to use that message, right, when there was actually a petition to do it. So it's obviously all very selective application of these regulations. But we bring this up, this Twitter string here where he talks about all these past incidences, to show you that it's a disingenuous point, that these people who are talking about this don't actually have a lot of evidence. If people are feeling motivated to vote for Morena and its candidates in this election, it's because they have seen the difference in governance. That, I think, it also speaks to the fact of how little respect they actually have for the Mexican population, like the Krauses of the world, the Lorenzo Cordovas of the world, who think that
the supposed historians, you know, who should know very well what happened in the past in Mexico, right?
Yeah, and so they continue to try to put forward this narrative. And I think, to be a bit cynical about it, I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that they are going to try to undermine the result after the fact. Right? They're going to say, oh, López Obrador's morning press conferences are the reason why this election should be thrown out. Or all of these efforts to try to convince people to vote for Morena, to keep their social programs, they should be thrown out because that's conditioning their vote, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's a strategy that speaks to the fact that they know that they are losing.
And that would go nowhere, but they're obviously counting on the U.S. media to try to chime in on this. Right? They're obviously counting on the U.S. Talking about tipping the scales, right? It's just so funny that they accuse, you know, a government like AMLO's of trying to tip the scale when, you know, any progressive government in Latin America has to go up against the right wing, the financial interests, the banks, the uniformity of the media, international institutions, the European Union, the United States. It's like, my God, my God, where's the scale tipped, first of all? Second of all, it's really funny that, just for example, the United States, the State Department came out last week with its annual human rights report, and it's wagging its finger at Mexico while they're beating the shit out of students. You know, everybody's seeing this. Everybody's seeing this, that they're wagging their finger at Mexico because of, you know, supposed human rights issues, right? Which, of course, they'll bring up after. While they're beating the shit out of students and teachers, professors in the United States. And just to finish on the Fox point, which is interesting, Fox himself has admitted this. He tried to keep AMLO off the ballot, the 2006 presidential ballot, by what was called the Desafuero Affair, which tried to keep him off the ballot by stripping him of his immunity over a, you know, trumped-up scandal about building a road to a hospital. And when that didn't work, he said that 2006, all of this that's in Hector's strings, was his desquite. It was, you know, his payback for the fact that he was failed at the Desafuero Affair. That is tipping the scales.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I wanted to just bring up this last tweet from that first string that I saw, where he says this farcical discussion around a state election shows that certain party-affiliated right-wing actors and their supporters, they just don't know how to cleanly win, and they don't know how to cleanly compete. And that Krause, if he's going to talk about this, should go study the state election that did actually happen in 2006 instead of talking about these absurd notions. Now, I mentioned as part of this discussion about the overreach of the electoral authority, and I get it. It's a delicate balancing act. I do think that there's a lot of political partisan interests behind this that are applying this selectively.
Yeah, it's a selective application, as you say, right?
But we have a really bad case of that happening right now here in Mexico City. So, you know, we usually try to stick to things related to the national campaign, but I do think that it's worth talking about Mexico City. My apologies to you, Kurt, that we haven't talked about Oaxaca enough, but we can, maybe on a future program. Sure. But talking about Mexico City, because it's largely seen as the second most important political post in this country. It is very key to the future of any political project to be successful in Mexico City. And oftentimes the person who is jefe o jefa de gobierno, the governor of Mexico City, is well poised to run in the next election for the presidency. Now, the electoral authority in Mexico City, we have a national electoral authority, and every state level or city level in this case has an electoral authority, which is similarly empowered to basically intervene directly in what the parties can or can't do or can or can't say. And one of the major issues here in Mexico City has been the cost of living, the explosion of housing costs, and also a very curious thing that happened, which was a dramatic increase in construction of new housing, expensive upper middle class housing in particular, in one of the more wealthier boroughs of Mexico City called Benito Juarez. And it came to be known as El Cartel Inmobiliario, or the housing cartel, which is basically, now some of people have been detained, some people are fleeing, are profugos, I don't know how you say that in English, fleeing from justice.
Fugitives of the law.
And they're very much tied to the candidate of, again, the PAN party here in Mexico City, who's running for the office of jefe de gobierno. And this has been a really a difficult way for them to actually advance in the campaign. It's been a major target of criticism of them, of their party, of the way that they have governed. It speaks to that legacy of corruption that weighs them down as being representatives of the PAN, of that old regime, et cetera, et cetera. And so
it's just to, you know, give a little bit of context before you go ahead with what the Electoral Institute said. This is a major scandal by anyone's measure. We're talking about over 1,000 families who are now living in irregular housing that they don't have title to because of this, you know, because they violated regulations. So they're out. they're out. They can't sell these apartments. They're stuck.
Yeah.
And this actually happened because some guy found out, it's like a movie, right? It's like he found out his air conditioning wasn't working, and then he started investigating, and then he started talking to his neighbors, and they started digging, and they found all these irregularities in the construction because all of these people, Christian von Rohrig, who's in prison, right? All of these panistas, the former delegate who's now in Congress, right? Created this scheme where they were getting kickbacks from construction companies to elude and to evade regulations on building codes.
And quite literally.
And this in one of the world's most highly dangerous cities for earthquakes. They were building extra floors.
Extra floors.
They were building extra floors, right?
Yeah.
In a seismic zone. They were not following basic regulations. They didn't have anything. And basically, this mafia, because it is a mafia, we're saying, we want X amount of money, to get to give you the go ahead in this.
Yeah, right? And so these are all public servants who were deeply inside of the institutions, the bureaucracy of the borough level government, who were all in on this allegedly, because some of these haven't been proven in a case in a court, but. Essentially,
and you know why they can't? And you know why they can't? Because they all of a sudden, the computers that had the records were magically stolen. The computers just were stolen. What a coincidence. And the documents themselves got water damage.
Yeah, they were lost in the flood.
They were lost in a flood. I mean, it's a mafia movie from beginning to end.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, now you have this electoral institute, which José Luis will explain now, is saying that Morena can't talk about it.
Yeah.
You can't talk about this. It's extraordinary.
It's extraordinary. So to recap, so we have the right-wing National Action Party, the PAN, accused of running this very complicated scheme with a number of actors aimed at enriching themselves because some of the kickbacks were like luxury apartments, right, in exchange for adding two extra floors to a building in a seismic zone. On a foundation that was not built to handle that kind of weight in 2017. Some of these buildings actually did fall down despite the fact they were brand new.
Come down, right? Yes. So one of these guys is being tried for homicide for that reason, right? Because people died in that.
And again, I think you make a really good point. Is this isn't Morena. It's not Morena went and submitted this complaint. It's the citizens who said, something's up here. Like, I bought this apartment and it turns out it's not even a legal build. What do I do with this? And so they've called this El Cartel Inmobiliario. And the PAN, knowing that this is really going to affect their interests, has gone to Mexico City's electoral authority and said and asked them to censor. And it is, I'm not being flippant with that word. It's censorship. It's saying, Morena, you're not allowed to talk about this issue using these terms anymore because we say so. And it's quite curious because we just finished doing an exercise looking at past examples of overreach of actual state intervening in the election. And here we have the Electoral Institute intervening in favor of the opposition, basically trying to silence them on an issue that I think is actually really quite important for the voters of Mexico City. Do we want Santiago Taboada, who is implicated in all of this, to be
We can't call him Santiago Taboada, right? Because that's one of the words that's been banned, right?
Oh, yeah. Come and serve.
It's just a list of many people. Obviously, we can, but
they do that. By the way, the INE, in this case, the ISM, can actually send thugs to your house to intimidate you to do as they say. It happened to a friend of ours, Alina Duarte, when she was involved with one of these complaints, where they literally go to your house and shove a bunch of documents in your face and demand you do this, or else. It's extraordinary.
They sent a requisition letter to Spain to the show the base, right, which had the affront of interviewing López Obrador, right, requisitioning all kinds of information about the interview, right? So the co-host over in Spain, Ina Avinojeva, took the papers and said, this is what we suggest you this is what we suggest you do with your requisition letter.
Yeah.
Right? And they were furious.
Of course they were. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm glad you bring that up because it was absurd. Like, did you coordinate with the candidate ahead of time in terms of what questions? It's like, why are we going to answer? Who are you? You're supposed to be the guardians of democracy and you're going after citizens who are engaged in the exercise of journalism? Come on. And it's interesting. I have a tweet up here from the alternate representative for Morena to the Electoral Institute. And even highlights this in the actual order. He says, we can use public force against you to force you to do this if you don't comply. Obviously, they are appealing, and it's likely to be overturned on appeal because...
They're likely to be overturned. But meanwhile, anyone who says anything like that in that window of time between the order and the appeal, that can then be used against them when they're qualifying the election afterwards because they violated a procedure. And it can be used as evidence to attempt to cancel the election. You see, this is why they do that.
Yeah. And I mean, gosh, we've talked about that before, but I hope that never comes to pass because it would cause huge civil conflict in this country. It would be the last desperate move of an old regime, really probably, if anything, just accelerating its own demise by radicalizing the population. We've seen what happens when your response mm-hmm. is repression. You tend to actually mobilize more. You talked about 2006 in Oaxaca. I think they're playing with fire if they think that that's actually going to work for them.
Agreed.
All right, so in our last 15 minutes here, let's talk about a regular segment here, which is the bad coverage of the week. And in this case, another one from AP, although this one is unsigned, if I'm not mistaken, so we don't know, just from the AP Wire's authors. Mexican president claims that criminal groups are, quote, respectful and, quote, respect the citizenry. Kurt, help us break this down. What is going on with
this is an especially dumb one, as we've grown accustomed to with the AP, right? So what it says is, Mexico's president said on Thursday, let's pull this up, that violent criminal gangs are essentially respectful people who respect the citizenry and mostly just each other. And then they go on. The claims are clearly at odds with the reality of millions of Mexicans who live in areas dominated by drug cartels. And then it goes on to say people from organized crime may be strange, but respectful. This is all very clearly part and parcel of an attempt to continue to play on the narco president, lie made up by ProPublica and New York Times and the Baker Institute in order to try to insinuate that AMLO is not only soft on crime, which has been a big AP thing, not only soft on crime, but actually in cahoots with the cartels. And that's why he calls them respectful or strange, but whatever, and it goes on to talk about the hugs, not bullets, which they continue to think is a strategy rather than a campaign slogan from 2018, right? But saying the cartels don't attack common sense and takes the issue to a new level, blah, blah, blah.
There's a line here that's up on the screen. López Obrador has long refused to directly confront the cartels. I think it's extraordinary when somebody, likely in Miami, writes a sentence like that. We know what directly confronting the cartels means. It means bloodshed. It means citizens being caught in the crossfire. It means human rights violations. It's like a laundry list of negative outcomes. And that some AP writer thinks that they're in a position to tut-tut the government policy because it doesn't adhere to the DEA's idea of what the war on drugs should look like is deeply offensive to me. When you write something like this, okay, so you want us to directly confront us. You want to go back to the streets running red with the blood of people dying as a result of these direct conflicts, the way that things were done when Felipe Calderon launched his poorly named so-called war on the cartels. Come on.
And, it's an attempt to put AMLO in a lose-lose situation. Because if he cracks down exactly like you're saying, oh my God, violent Mexico and human rights violations and, killings and, all of this, right? You can see the headlines. But if he, adopts approach that, favors, attacking the root causes and, avoiding direct confrontations when unnecessary, it's always soft on crime. And not only is he soft on crime, he's in their pocket. He loves going to their places. He loves going to the towns where the cartels are. Right? And if you go back to that mañanera, and if you go back to the exchange, go back and listen to it. It's on April 25th. All the mañaneras are online. You can watch it yourself. What AMLO was talking about was that, you know, very opposed to the U.S. idea that the cartels are in control of large swaths of the country. He can travel to anywhere in the country without security because he disbanded the presidential detail, right? He disbanded the Mexican Secret Service. And, you know, can go to Chiapas, he can go to the north, he can go to wherever, right? By way of saying that, you know, the media overplays things. Was it the best thing to say that most killings happen just between cartel members? Probably not. You know, probably not. But this attempt to portray AMLO as a friend of the cartels is utter nonsense. And it's not what he said.
Yeah.
It's not what he said. Go back and listen to it. He's talking about how he can travel safely through the country because he has, you know, he has the public on his side.
Yeah. Also, like, right? There is a bias revealed in the fact that this is a story at all, right? Either the writer pitched it or the editor asked for it, right? And they're like, this is going to be the article that we're going to put out in English about López Obrador because it fits all the narrative, because it's convenient for us, because we know that this will garner clicks, even though it's not really an accurate representation of all the things that were talked about during the press conference that day. All right? We could go on. But we're almost out of time, and I wanted to mention one more thing, because you talked about how this is part of the grand narrative. This is part of that, you know, Deutsche Welle story that talked about illegal financing of his campaign. Who is set to publish a book very soon? Well, It's going to be our friend Anabel Hernández publishing, who was the author of that Deutsche Welle piece, who actually went one step further than all the other ones, than the one from Inside Crime and the other one that was published around the same time, where she actually said, no, I have proof that there was financing of the 2018 campaign, and I'm going to reveal it in due time. She had a fantastic, I always talk about it, it's a masterclass of Astillero interviewing Anabel Hernández and being like, but you have to give us more than your word, right? You can't just publish based on your sources say, right? And of course, she didn't have a good answer, but here it is. She promised it would be coming in time, and a few days ago, it was announced that she's publishing a book called The Secret History, AMLO and the Sinaloa Cartel. Boy, I bet that's going to sell a lot of books. And I've mentioned this, and I think that ultimately, as soon as it's published, I will not be surprised to learn that it will probably be poorly sourced. There will probably be lots of wild, outrageous accusations that are attributed to my sources say, or this, you know, pseudonym said, et cetera, et cetera. And that's a problem. I don't think we should outright say that we cannot trust anonymous sources. They are valuable. There are cases where it makes sense, but they also have to be corroborated. And Anabel Hernández has been incapable of corroborating her claims. And this is not a new thing. And this is not just because, oh, now she's going after López Obrador and Morena, and therefore that's why I'm being critical. I actually went through the trouble of finding an older tweet that I made back in 2022, where, again, she was talking about the case in Tamaulipas and, again, trying to link Morena to organized crime groups. And I mentioned this at the time. Her work is basically unreliable because her sources are almost always unnamed, unknown insiders. They all do this. And again, I'm not the only person to do this. I found this old review of one of her other books that talks about this. And here it says, Hernández has a source problem. She has sources, of course, but she's not always as clear as who she might be about or who or what they are, even bearing in mind her duty to protect their identities. So the London Review of Books, in this review of A Massacre in Mexico, The True Story Behind the Missing and 43 Students, yeah. Rachel Nolan, right? So I think in this case, right, this is a story about the missing, the forcibly disappeared 43 students from Ayotzinapa. It's, you know, it was an interesting exercise. I think there were some elements there that I think were unknown, but it was basically retelling the narrative and things like that. But the fact that in this story, somebody pointed out that same fact, I think helps us understand that Anabel Hernández has a source problem. And it's gotten to the degree that it makes her work unreliable. And in fact, believe it or not, she actually replied to this trying to defend herself Sorry, it's a long review, so I have to get to the letters here. And you can see this is actually Anabel Hernández's direct response to that very line, talking about her source problem. And she even readily admits it and says, on this, there are indeed no footnotes or endnotes. So not a very good defense. I mention that because this book's going to come out. It's coming out in May, if I'm not mistaken. Let me double check that. It just says soon, but it should be coming out during this election period, and it's going to cause a lot of waves, and I think we should be ready for it. But I will not be surprised if, once again, Anabel Hernández has a source problem.
And I think, you know, the point is, anonymous sources are valuable if they lead to sourced information.
Right.
Right? If you get a tip that leads you to a document, yeah, then you have to protect the source that led you to that document. But the anonymous sources have to lead somewhere. And the problem that we had with all of the pieces that so coincidentally came out at the same time, right, which was ProPublica, which is Insight Crime, which is Deutsche Welle, you know, anybody knows, is they were based on, you know, someone said.
Yep.
Someone said. And trust me. Trust me because I'm the New York Times. Trust me because I'm ProPublica. Trust me because I'm Anabel Hernández. Well, why do we have to do that? Why can't we insist on better sourcing? And the problem is when you insist on better sourcing, Anabel Hernández in particular gets very, very upset.
Oh, yeah.
Gets very, very upset. She bristles. She starts to, you know, she takes as an offense, an attack. You know, and Julio Hernández pointed out, you know, there has to be, you know, something here. And she says, well, you didn't mind when, you know, when I was going after Garcia Luna. You know, there has to be something here that doesn't smell like the DEA and doesn't conveniently come out a month before the election.
Yep.
And everyone has the right to ask questions about the timing as well, you know. Well, that's my 2 cents on that.
We'll see what actually comes out in a matter of weeks, I imagine. All right, Kurt, we've reached the end of another program. Thanks again for such a great exchange of ideas and discussion here on Soberania, the Mexican Politics Podcast. And as always, we'll be back next week with another episode breaking down the week's events as we get closer and closer. We're really actually very, very close to the election at this point, just a little bit over a month away, where we will determine the future of Mexico. But as things go, it looks like it's going to be a smooth ride for Morena here on out. I do think it might be interesting to look at some of the local races as well, because if as things kind of consolidate at the national level, there's still a lot to look at in terms of what's happening elsewhere in this country and what that'll imply, right? Will Morena be able to secure that majority or even the supermajority in the Congress, which will be really, really consequential?
Yeah. So we've got a few more episodes before the election to cover that ground. So my name is Kurt Hackbarth, and we'll see you next time as we head into double-digit episodes of Soberania.
Don't forget to like and subscribe and share with your friends. Really appreciate all of you tuning in. I'm José Luis Granados Ceja.